Hey guys, I'm taking a look at six different ways of measuring your VO2 max. I'm going to see how they all compare and whether you need to test yourself to failure to get an accurate reading. So, what is VO2 max? VO2 max is a measure of the maximal volume of oxygen your body can utilize. And it's a good indicator of cardiovascular fitness. It's measured in milliliters of oxygen per kilo of body weight per minute. How do you test it? A true VO2 max test involves fitting the subject with a rather flattering mask and making them exercise to failure. This is conducted in a lab and is usually quite expensive. What I'll be doing is trying out six free methods that are going to give me an estimate of my VO2 max. So what is a good score? When it comes to VO2 max, good is a relative term and the answer will be based on two things, your gender and your age. Here is one set of normative data for VO2 max for men and women. You can get a rough idea of what a score would mean for your age range with a rating of 1 to 7, which I've color-coded. So if you're a young guy and you score 35, that gets you a 2 or a 3, either poor or below average. If you're over 55 and get the same score, that puts you as above average or good. If you want to work the other way, you can find your age range on the left and read across until you see 4, which is average. I'm 31, so average for me is about 40. What do elite athletes score? Starting from the middle, professional ice hockey players at the NHL Combine scored an average of 56. In Norway's top division of football, the average was 58. And the Premier League, it's around 60 to 65. A group of elite female triathletes averaged 66, and the average Division I distance runners in American colleges, the NCAA, measured 70 to 75. In terms of individuals, one of the Tour de France winners scored 85, and the highest numbers come from cross-country skiers who've been known to score 90 or above. It's important to bear in mind that elements like strength, speed, and skill are often more important than raw fitness when it comes to being an elite athlete. On to my results. So my six tests are a non-exercise test, in other words, a survey, a step test, a bleep test, a 1 mile walk, 1 mile jog, and the Cooper test. Let's get the simplest one out of the way, which is a non-exercise test. Over at worldfitnesslevel.org, they have a 3-minute questionnaire to estimate your VO2 max. I need to enter my height and weight, resting heart rate and waist measurement, then tell them how often I exercise, for how long and at what intensity. For resting heart rate, count your pulse for 15 seconds at rest and multiply by 4. Based on my information, that gives me an estimated VO2 max of 52. Next up is the first physical test, which is going to be the Queen's College step test, also known as the home step test. For this, you're going to need a metronome, a stopwatch, a tape measure, and a step. Now, the step has to be around 41 centimeters, hence the need for a tape measure. You can get a metronome on Google by searching metronome or finding a free app. For guys, you're setting it to 96 beats per minute, for women, 88. You're going to step up and down for 3 minutes, then immediately after, count your heartbeat for 15 seconds. I recommend locating your pulse first so you aren't rushing to find it after the test. The easiest places to feel it are your wrist, temple, or my favourite, the side of your neck. So here I go. Notice the up, up, down, down rhythm. Keep going for 3 minutes, and then as soon as I finish, I'm timing 15 seconds and counting my heartbeats. So I scored 37 in 15 seconds, multiply by 4 to get beats in a minute, which is 148. That goes into the formula over at brianmack.com and it comes out at 49.17. My third method is the gym class favourite, the bleep test. You'll need a set of cones, a recording of the bleep test, possibly additional speakers, and a tape measure that's at least 20 metres long. You're going to set the cones 20 meters apart. I recommend putting the audio recording in the middle so you can hear it clearly at both ends. Start the audio and the goal is to get to the other side and touch your foot on the line before the beep. Level 1 is very slow and the beeps get closer together as the levels increase. If you miss one, you can try and make up the time, but be honest about when you're not making the line fast enough. This is a maximal test, so try your hardest. With this test, I made it to level 9, shuttle 11. I plug that into the formula, and it gives me 46.57. The final three all take place on an athletics track. We'll start with the easiest of the three, which is a 1 mile walk. 1 mile is 1,609 meters, slightly more than 4 laps. If you walk back from the start line, you'll see a curved white line, and it should also have a marker on the inside of the track to indicate a 1 mile start. Starting from this line, do 4 laps, then through to the finish line. Walk as fast as you can, time how long it takes you, and your 15 second pulse as soon as you finish. There's a bit more information needed for this one, so I enter my weight and age, then my heart rate and my finishing time.
35 beats in 15 seconds, so 140 for my pulse, and I did it in 12 minutes, 33.9.
That comes out at 52.21. A very similar one next, a 1 mile jog. Now this has to be a jog, and you're not allowed to finish faster than 8 minutes for men or 9 minutes for women. I went round at a very relaxed pace, crossing the line in 9 minutes 33 seconds. 33 has to be converted to a decimal, so 33 over 60 is 0.55, so 9.55, my weight and my heart rate of 156, which gives me 53.45. The last one is called the Cooper test, and you have to run as far as you can in 12 minutes round a track. This time I started on the finish line. I did just over 6.5 laps, which was 2,630 meters. It's a very simple calculator here. I just enter the distance and I get 47.51. So here's my 6 scores. The bleep test gave me the lowest estimated VO2 max and the mile jog gave me the highest. Overall, I was impressed by how close the numbers were to each other, and I think 50 is probably a good estimate, which puts me in the good category. So the easiest ones to complete were obviously the 1 mile walk and the step test, with the bleep test and the 12 minute run being the two maximal effort tests. The added difficulty with the 12 minute run is knowing how to pace yourself. If I show you my lap times, you'll see I clearly set off too slowly. If I repeated the test, I think I could go another 100 meters with the right pacing. The great thing about the heart rate tests is that they are non-maximal, so you don't need to worry about mentally pushing yourself to get the best score. What VO2 max is good for is measuring changes in your own fitness level over time. What it isn't good at, again depending on which test is conducted, is comparing individuals with each other. So for example, if you're a recreational runner, you will have an advantage in technique over a swimmer or a cyclist in the running test. If everyone had the same level of fitness, I would expect the runner to score the highest. You could also have an inefficient running technique which will compromise your times. For professional athletes who take the real test, your results could be used to find your heart rate training zones. If you need to train at 70% VO2 max, you can find out what your heart rate was at that point in the test and aim for that during your session. This might differ slightly from simply using 220 minus your age as your heart rate max. I hope you found this interesting. Please subscribe to my channel for more videos on fitness, strength, and nutrition. Cheers.